Good afternoon, and welcome to this fourth session of a six-week educational speaker series brought to you in collaboration with the Brain Injury Association of Windsor and Essex County, Beyond Disabilities Rehabilitation Network in Windsor, and the Brain Changes Initiative in Toronto. We gratefully thank our partners at Hôtel-Dieu Grace Healthcare in Windsor for presenting this series via Zoom. I'm Anna Jurak. I'm the Executive Director of the Brain Injury Association of Windsor and Essex County. Our mission is to enhance the lives of those affected by an acquired brain injury through education, awareness, and support. So please check out what we do by going to our website at www.biawe.com. We want to thank our presenting sponsor, Greg Montfort and Partners, for their support of this series, as it allows us to bring this program free to you. Greg founded Greg Montfort and Partners Injury Lawyers in Windsor more than 40 years ago, and has been helping Ontario residents fight for the justice they deserve. This firm has proudly become one of the most sought-after injury law firms in the region, not only because of their experience and education, but also because of their strong relationship with treatment providers and their support of the community. Their goal is to ensure their clients have access to the best available care. Greg Montfort's firm chose to sponsor this initiative because they believe that together with our partners, we can make an important and lasting difference in supporting those who need us the most. So on behalf of the partners in this series, I want to thank Greg and his team for this incredible sponsorship. And now I'll turn it over to Melanie Garden, representing the Beyond Disabilities Rehabilitation Network.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. As Anna said, I'm Melanie Garden, and I'm a board member with Beyond Disability. We are physically located inside Hôtel-Dieu Grace Healthcare, but because of the pandemic, we've been operating virtually. We're a collaborative network of community-based organizations. Some are not-for-profit, some are charitable, and some are volunteer. We all come together under one umbrella to network. We work on common projects and issues, and we all lend our individual voices to come together on issues that matter. We have approximately 19 members, and all of our members, in some way or another, serve those living with a chronic disability. So some examples include ALS, brain injury, stroke, amputees, multiple sclerosis, and spinal cord injuries, or any number of developmental, intellectual, or acquired disabilities. We're always open to adding new members. Our goal is to enhance the lives of those living with chronic disabilities. If you're interested, you can find us on the website, beyonddisability.ca, or find us on Facebook. I'm now going to turn it over to Dr. Matthew Galati.
Welcome, everybody, to Lifestyle Approaches for Better Brains and Bodies. I'm Dr. Matthew Galati. I'm a brain injury survivor, medical doctor, and the founder of Brain Changes Initiative. So Brain Changes was founded in 2019, inspired by my own story of healing and recovery from traumatic brain injury and the lifestyle approach that I use to heal my own brain. The mission of Brain Changes is to improve the standard of care for traumatic brain injury through funding research around this lifestyle approach, education events like the amazing speaker series we bring to you today in collaboration with our partners, and through advocacy and awareness. We have, for example, runs through Hyde Park every Sunday to spread awareness for the positive effects of exercise on the brain. So if you're in the Toronto region, please come out and come for a run on Sundays. We start at 9 a.m. through Hyde Park. So I'd like to thank our partners on this event and our speakers, Dr. Celeste Thirlwell and Ian Towns. And on that note, I'll hand it over to our moderator for today, Bryn Milner.
Hi, sorry, I forgot to take off the video. Apologies. Hi, good afternoon. My name is Bryn Milner. I'm a social worker who works with BrainWorks Rehab up in Huntsville. It is my honor to be here this afternoon and to be moderating. So thank you very much for letting me be part of this. Before I introduce Dr. Celeste Thirlwell, I would just like to ask the people who are watching to put any questions that you may have into the question and answer part of at the bottom of your screen, and we will take note and go over those throughout the session, and I believe there's time at the end to address questions. And I'd like to take a moment to introduce Dr. Celeste Thirlwell. She is a sleep medicine specialist and psychiatrist with a background in neurosurgery and neuroscience research. She completed her medical degree in psychiatry specialty training at McMaster University. She is the founder and director of the Sleep Wake Awareness Program, which provides comprehensive multimodal treatment for sleep wake health issues. She has presented nationally and internationally on insomnia, post-concussion syndrome, post-traumatic stress disorder, fibromyalgia syndrome, chronic fatigue syndrome, pulse electromagnetic field therapy, and medical cannabis therapy. She has worked extensively with Canadian veterans suffering from traumatic brain injury, insomnia, PTSD, and chronic fatigue. She continues to search for innovative neuroscience-based strategies to optimize the care of her patients and is incorporating innovative approaches such as yoga, MBSR, EMDR, image rehearsal therapy, medical cannabis, and electromagnetic field modalities such as pulse electromagnetic field therapy and photo biomodulation into our practice. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Dr. Thirlwell. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I also want to introduce my co-presenter today, Dr. Ian Town, who is a chiropractor specialized in the treatment of concussion with functional neurology. And together we work hand in hand to bring our patients back to functionality in terms of their concussion, both physically, mentally, emotionally, and within their work lives, their family lives, their professional lives. So we're happy to be here today. Thank you for all the sponsors for bringing this together and Brain Changes Initiative for providing the inspiration to help us collaborate and move forward to improve the standard of care of patients. So I'll start with our first slide. So we're going to speak to you today about brain trauma and sleep. And really the way that we've come to look at it, and I have to admit, I've been inspired by Dr. Town and his hands-on approach to really making the nervous system come alive for me and understanding the repair of the nervous system after concussion, in addition to how the mismatch of input from the outside world and output from the inside world that gets interrupted with concussion. And we see that most prominently in sleep. And as far as I'm concerned, sleep is the fire alarm of the brain. When you have problems with sleep, we know something's wrong with the system. And in the case of concussion, there's something wrong with the brain. Next slide. Next slide. And as it was presented, I'm founder of the Sleep Wake Awareness Program, where we use multimodal approach to deal with many sleep issues. One of our strong focus is concussion, but we also focus on PTSD, and I'm a top specialist in insomnia. And people ask me what I do. I say, well, I believe in the neuroelectric grid of the body, and I believe in photobiomodulation, meaning that we can repair the nervous system when we recognize that it's actually a neuroelectric grid. So it's beyond the physical, beyond the biochemical. There's actually a neuroelectric grid that gets disrupted with concussion. If you recharge that grid the same way you recharge your cell phone, we can get the neurons firing and wiring again together. But if the wiring isn't in place, next slide, then all the charging is not going to help. And this is why Dr. Ian Town is the neuronal circuitry guy that I work with, and he works with neuronal patterns. So I start to recharge the system with photobiomodulation and improving sleep, and he helps to repattern it so the nervous system can start working properly. If you want to look at concussion like a circuit board, your brain is a circuit board. When any trauma happens, a lot of the circuits go offline and they need to be relearned and redone in terms of retraining. Next slide. Some of the topics we're going to highlight today, there'll be a lot of information, but these are the key points we wanted to keep you in mind. The autonomic nervous system is made of the on system, which is the sympathetic nervous system. So that's the fight, flight, and hide part of your nervous system. And then you have the off part of your nervous system, the parasympathetic nervous system, the relax, restore, maintain. When any trauma happens, especially concussion, the sympathetic nervous system goes into overdrive, and the parasympathetic nervous system is nowhere to be found. So that will interrupt sleep at night, that will cause increased anxiety, it will cause increased arousal, both physically, mentally, and emotionally. Then you have an input-output mismatch. We'll explain more to you. Sleep gets disrupted. In the early stages of concussion, there's excessive daytime sleepiness. Later stages of concussion that translate into insomnia. And with concussion, not only is there the nervous system that is affected, the inflammatory system is affected, the endocrine system is affected, neuronal circuitry patterns are affected, as we said, and we're going to look finally at the functional neurology approach to all of this and photobiomodulation approach and summarize, give you some clinical pearls at the end for a multimodal approach for you to apply in clinic. Next slide. The beauty about the brain is it's neuroplastic. And it used to be believed that the brain cells, once you lost them, they never regrew. But that's been debunked over the last 15 to 20 years. And what makes up of our brain really is the moment you have more than two neurons growing in that little fetus, they are sending messages to each other and then setting up circuitry patterns that are part of learning. And we're going to go more into that as we go on through this presentation. Next. As I said, the autonomic nervous system is very important. And I think Dr. Tan wanted to speak with you about the autonomic nervous system a bit.
Yep, it's the main focus of recovery from, because it's triggered, it's what's triggered all the time. When people are looking at the sympathetic nervous system, it's supposed to be something that's an emergency system, and you can't live in the emergency system. When it's kicked in, you can't repair, you can't digest, you can't absorb. It kicks off your front lobe, so your short-term memory is gone. So it's something we're going to show a whole bunch of information about and how to get it offline and get the parasympathetic back on.
So that you can sleep again.
So that you can sleep again and heal again and have a conversation and remember that you had the conversation.
Next slide. So I just wanted to draw your attention to, I don't know, most of you know how mild traumatic brain injury is sort of set up in terms of percentages, but I want you to think about the causes. Think about what it is to fall suddenly, or to suddenly be assaulted, or suddenly have been a motor vehicle accident or struck by someone or something out of the blue when you don't expect it. That's not only going to be traumatic to your brain, it's going to be traumatic to your emotional system and to your life, because many times your old way of being is completely gone. Next slide. So I really want to impinge upon you that in terms of concussion and when we're looking at recovering from brain injury, we really need to be talking about traumatic brain injury and PTSD in one breath, and in between all the neuroemotional things that go on in terms of irritability, cognitive deficits, depression, fatigue, anxiety. And as you notice, the center point of this is insomnia. Insomnia and how your patients sleep will tell you how well they are doing in terms of their healing and how badly deranged the patterns are mismatched in terms of the injury. And really, functional neurology and photobiomodulations help reset the autonomic nervous system, so bring it back into balance, boosting the parasympathetic nervous system. These modalities also help recorrect the neuronal circuitry and help correct the input-output mismatch that happens with concussion. Next slide. This is the definition of PTSD, and I just wanted to just let you have a glance of that because we don't often talk about the emotional piece, but you need to see that many of these symptoms are a function of an increased sympathetic nervous system tone, including the sleep problems. Next slide. If you're not aware of the polyvagal theory, I would suggest that you look into the polyvagal theory, and it talks about the brain being divided into three major components. One, the brainstem, then the midbrain where the amygdala and the limbic system are, then the frontal lobe. And in any trauma, physical, mental, emotional, the frontal lobe goes offline. The emotional system, the midbrain, can run amok because there is no top-down processing. And really what takes over is the brainstem nuclei, which really run on fight and flight and power that sympathetic nervous system tone drive. Next slide. Here's an article that looked at sleep-wake disruptions in patients when they first came into the emergency and when they left. And there is a decrease in hypocretin 1, a wake-promoting neurotransmitter, when they are first injured. So that leads to excessive daytime sleepiness. And 6 months out, insomnia was more of the clinical picture. Next slide. I want to make you aware of the difference between sleepiness and fatigue. Fatigue is an uncontrollable urge to fall asleep. And many of your concussed patients may in fact have obstructive or central sleep apnea, restless leg syndrome, or narcolepsy. And so you want to be able to screen them for this because these sleep disorders interrupt healing and interrupt sleep. Fatigue is a completely different issue, and most people with concussion might have both. And fatigue is an uncontrollable urge to fall asleep, but you can't. You're tired but wired. And that accompanies insomnia, fibromyalgia, infections, and other diseases. Next slide. Here are a few studies that have looked at insomnia and traumatic brain injury. And you can see that Wellett and al. Found that out of 452 patients with traumatic brain injury, 50% of patients endorsed insomnia symptoms. And we can go all the way back to 1979 when there were some early studies that look at traumatic brain injury and insults to the suprachiasmatic nucleus in the brain and its output. And so we can see that insomnia must be looked at in traumatic brain injury. Next slide. When a person doesn't sleep and they have this increased sympathetic nervous system tone, and it's like you have a light switch in your brain, you're trying to turn off, but the on switch, the sympathetic nervous system, keeps on flipping the light switch back on. What is experienced is non-restorative sleep, daytime fatigue, increased inflammatory factors, chronic musculoskeletal pain, poor memory and concentration. And if we go to the next slide, you're going to see that's not much different than what represents in post-concussion syndrome. Again, you see the cognitive, physical, affective, and sleep issues, all which are made worse by the poor sleep. Next slide. Now, you're very familiar with the pathophysiology of concussion, but I just want to highlight to you that what happens is there is increased metabolic activity as the brain tries to restore balance, and this affects the cerebral blood flow. There can also be impingement on cerebral spinal fluid, and so there's an energy crisis and there's a mismatch between supply and demand, which forms a cascade that we will see in the next slide that is detrimental to the brain tissue. There's the acute phase and then the chronic phase. Next. In the acute phase, we see all these things that occur: excitotoxicity, with an influx of calcium, harming the neurons even further, inflammation and edema, reduction of blood flow and oxygen, which harms the brain cells even further, neuronal cell death and damage, and loss of synapses. And this is a vicious cycle in the acute phase. Next slide. Blood-brain barrier can be also compromised in the acute phase. And whenever there's toxicity in the brain will go, oh my goodness, there's inflammatory factors, there's toxicity, I can't turn off, there's danger. And so your brain will not let you sleep. Sometimes it's completely overwhelmed by the toxins and it'll make you excessively sleepy. Next. Again, the cerebrospinal flow is very important. And we wanted to highlight that with whiplash, there might be brainstem impingement, meaning that the cerebral blood flow can be impinged upon and blocked in an intermittent way that will give symptoms that occur very suddenly and disappear very suddenly, often leading doctors not to believe what patients are telling them. Next slide. With insomnia, there is increasing stimulation of the inflammatory system. And with increased release of inflammatory factors such as IL-6 and tumor necrosis factor, there is increasing stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system and increasing insomnia. So this becomes a self-perpetuating loop. Next slide. Another factor in post-concussion syndrome, which is not being looked into and which I want to emphasize, is the effect on the endocrine system. And this must be properly looked at if you want to help sleep and improve overall mind-body health for your patients. Adrenal fatigue occurs when the nervous system has been on in sympathetic drive and does not turn off properly, such as with insomnia and high stress states. Eventually, the cortisol surge that is required to wake up in the morning never occurs because there is no cortisol left. And in which case, you will see your patients displaying many of these issues. I want to draw to your attention that your concussion patients may have difficulty getting up in the morning, and they find that they have better energy between 10 a.m. and 2 p.m., and they become low again at 3 to 4. That's because they are not getting deep sleep through the earlier part of the evening and are probably sleeping deeply closer to 7, 8, 9 a.m. in the morning. So if you try and wake them up and get them on a work hardening schedule, that is only going to further undermine their progress. Many, many, many people with concussions get the deeper sleep towards the latter part of the sleep cycle. And this is because the pressure for sleep finally gets strong enough to override the fight and flight mechanisms so that they finally do get some deeper sleep or even REM. The other thing I want to impinge upon you is the presence of fibrofog and that foggy feeling in their brain. That is in part the lack of cortisol to wake them up, also the increased inflammatory factors, as well as damage to the tissues. Next slide. As time goes on, as we lead the acute state into the more chronic state, we're looking at ongoing psychological stressors. The stresses of not being able to return to school, the stresses of not being able to return to work, the stresses of not being able to handle daily life cause more inflammation, which in turn causes more psychological distress and more inflammation, and then further issues with sleep. Next slide. Another important part that is not being paid attention to, but is coming to the fore in the literature, is glyphatic system transmission. And this is the glial cells of the brain. And they haven't been well studied up until the last 5 or 6 years, but sleep is needed for the glial cells to work properly and release toxins through the venous system. So it's very important that we maintain sleep to get rid of the neurotoxic waste. If not, your brain is sitting in a cesspool of waste. Next slide. In sleep, there are four stages. There is stage one, which is very light sleep. Then you go into stage two, then slow wave sleep, which is deep sleep, and then REM. That is where you dream. Sorry, I was reading someone's chat question. We'll come to the chat questions at the end. All of these four stages can be interrupted by sympathetic bursts that wake the brain up from whatever stage they are in. Next slide, we'll show you this. The highlighted parts are where sympathetic drive is coming in throughout the night. And this is a 5-minute epoch. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times within a 5-minute epoch, there is a fight and flight response in the brain triggered by the sympathetic nervous system. This is like someone poking your arm all night long. How are you going to feel in the morning? Fatigued. This is pretty much ubiquitous across traumatic brain injury patients. Next slide. And now we're going to come back to the autonomic nervous system, and Dr. Tan will speak to you about circuits and mismatch.
Okay, so we've touched on the sympathetic nervous system and the parasympathetic nervous system, and we really need to turn the sympathetic nervous system off. It's detrimental to you getting better. It doesn't allow you to heal. It doesn't allow you to focus. It's a crisis management problem. So you can't stay in hyper mode all the time. So with the sympathetic nervous system, the way to get at it is to look at where it crosses with the conscious system. So we want to hack it primarily, well, with breathing. We want to be aware of when it's on, and there's a bunch of different strategies that we have that we're going to go through to show you how to turn it off, and then give you some factors that have to be in place for you to be able to retrain your brain. And that's what today we want to emphasize. So what we're looking at is things that have the trauma from whatever, it can be emotionally, it can be physical, it can be mental. The trauma dysregulates the input. So the brain works 40-1 on input to output. And when you look at the input from, well, as a concussion was primarily what I work with, the data has been corrupted coming in. So the person, say, look at the vision. So the vision input, the problem that the medical doctors are looking at primarily is that they look at the eye and the eye is fine. And then they do a CAT scan of the brain and the brain itself is fine. So they're not seeing the problem. And the problem is the way the brain is taking the information and processing it. So when we look at the visual input from the eye is now offline. So the actual physical eye is still working, but the information taken to being processed is not working. So that the eye sees the information, but say I'm walking down the street and I walk through a shadow, my pupil should change size and it should limit the amount of the information coming in, but the pupil's not responding. So now the message to the eye, the processing isn't happening. It sends the message, there's no response. And then because there's no response and you've been startled by the change in the lights, now it kicks in your sympathetics. Now your sympathetics have been kicked in. Now it kicks off your frontal lobe. Now you've kicked off your frontal lobe. That shuts down your stomach. Now you're not digesting or you're purging. We need to shut that all down. I'll turn it back here. Dr. Thirlwell, I think this one's yours.
How the post-concussion with post-concussion syndrome, you really want to not have that overload of the system. If you push your system too hard, too fast, you're going to wind up causing more inflammation, more distress to the mismatch of the system, and greater sleep problems. along with cognitive issues and mood issues. So the trick is to stay within your threshold and not push beyond it until your system has been rectified in terms of the patterns and the mismatch and in terms of the actual charging of the electromagnetic grid of the body and healing with nutrients to the nervous system and the tissues. Next slide.
Okay, so the way I'm looking at this now is I'm looking at how the brain works and the brain works with patterns. The whole brain is set up on pattern recognition. So what's a pattern? A pattern is a recreation of a conscious action. So it starts when you're born. One of the first things you do is you learn how to control your eyes, and it has to be consciously initially, and it's with response to the stimulus coming in. So we first were able to start focusing, and then we start to be able to track, and then we start to tie that into our sound. So these patterns are created, and why they're created is because it takes a lot of energy to be consciously doing things all the time. But you have to do that to create the pattern. So when you first learn to crawl, you first learn to walk, you can't concentrate on anything else because your brain is focused on doing that task. After you learn that task and the brain makes a pattern of it, it frees up your conscious and now you can do something else. So you see people who can't walk and talk, well, they haven't got the walking pattern down yet. So once they get the walking pattern down, then it's in their patterns. Now they can do walking and talking and you can expand on that. The brain is trying to help you, it really is, but it's only doing the best it can without input a lot of times. So we have to tell our brain what to do. So that's part of where we're going with this is understanding that it makes patterns, and it makes patterns whether you're aware of it or not. So the patterns are in any area. So they're not just physical patterns for walking, they're emotional patterns. So we'll have emotional triggers that are patterns that we've built. So what we have to do is understand how that we have them, and then we can get on with fixing them. So what do patterns do? Well, as we're saying, they're to free up your conscious thought. So it's your brain is trying to help you, but does what is directed to do. So one of my ones I talk about is with the keys. So if I've misplaced my keys and I say to my brain, I can't find my keys, it will look for information that supports that statement that I can't find my keys. So it will help me not find my keys. Well, it's trying to help, but I've given it the wrong input. So I have to work with the input. So I have to tell the brain, I'm going to see my keys when I see them. I will remember where I put my keys. Then my brain will look for the right information to help me with that pattern. So bring patterns back online. So this one's yours?
Yeah, you continue. Yep.
Okay, so bring patterns back online. There's two problems. One is that we've heard for many years, no pain, no gain. Well, that's great if you're going to the gym and you want to push your muscles. But with the brain, you can't do that. There's two problems. One is the metabolic wall that you hit. We're using neurons that, as I said, when it takes a lot of energy to consciously be doing everything all the time. So you actually fatigue the actual energy in the cells, and then you crash and burn. And if you try and push yourself past that, you'll actually lose ground instead of gaining ground. So if you're doing really well and then you crash or you feel the crash coming on, you need to stop. And that's the hardest thing I think I have to teach patients is that this, when you start to feel your trigger, you're done. You can't keep pushing. It's the same for all patterns. So if you're talking to somebody, well, I equate it to Weight Watchers. In Weight Watchers, you're given this many points for the day, and when you're done your points, you're done. You shouldn't be eating anything else. It doesn't matter whether you had lasagna or chocolate cake. When your points are done, you're done. The same thing with concussion treatment. So the person gets this is how many points you have, and when you've used unfortunately when they're a bad concussion, they'll use up half their points getting to my office. So getting in the car, being mobile in the car, being going past different light sources, different sound sources, and that's assuming that there's the driving is good. Once I use up those points, they get to my office and I can't even do a full assessment because they haven't got enough points left. So what's problems, trauma, physical, emotional, mental, psychological, they'll all damage the input, and you build a pattern that's not helping you. So we need to understand that we built these patterns, and then find a way to turn off the sympathetic nervous system so that we can change our patterns. So part of how we do that is we get you to be in a safe place, right? So when you're in a safe place, you actually tell yourself physically, you're in a safe place and we're going to change this pattern. And then the problem is the brain likes to, whatever you're doing, it doesn't judge what you're doing. It wants you to keep doing that. So when you try and change behaviors, it resists change. So that's where the mindfulness comes in too, is the mindfulness, you come into the situation where you're trying to make a change, you tell yourself you're in a safe place, you say, I'm going to change this behavior, and then you tell yourself that even though you're changing this behavior and you feel the resistance is okay, and you just let it wash through you without it being affected with you, so you're not kicking in your central nervous, your sympathetic nervous system, and you're not kicking your frontal lobe offline. So it starts with a vision. There's two parts to the vision. There's the input from the eye, and then there's a processing of the information in the brain. And people who have loss of function with the eye, it's not the eye. Their eyes are okay. So it's rehabilitating the brain and bringing the brain back online. And it has to be done slowly. So we start with a small flashing light. We start with eye exercises to bring the eye back online so that you can get the pupils working again, so you can have some protection. We bring the eye back online so that they're accommodating properly, so that you have depth perception again, so you know where you are in space. Because when you don't know where you are in space, you try and move, it startles you, it kicks in your sympathetic nervous system. So that's the whole thing that we need to get out of those patterns. So the patterns that you're bringing, again, it doesn't judge, it just tries to make patterns, it's trying to help you. So once we understand that it makes these patterns, then we understand how to make them consciously, and then we can build better patterns, and then we can get things back online. Then we can get back to having a full night's sleep because we can turn off the sympathetic nervous system. So with the vision, so I talked about is the properly functioning eye, the pupil responds to the changes in light levels. Well, when somebody's had a concussion or damage from whatever source, the post-traumatic, emotional damage, the eye is not getting the feedback from the brain. So the mechanics of the eye are still there, but if I look in the office, I'll shine a light in the eye and the eye will stay fully dilated, or it'll just momentarily constrict and it goes, and it's called hippus, where the eye opens up again and doesn't hold that. So it's a metabolic problem, it's a pattern problem, that's been disrupted. And part of how these come is when the brain is first injured, it tries to dumb down its functions to continue to function. So my analogy is when I broke my leg. I did a really good job of it. I broke it into 8 pieces. I was 4 months in a cast. I finally got the cast off. The leg had healed. They did the physio with me. They did the rehab. I got the full range of motion and I got the full strength back. And I still had a really bad limp. And the limp was not because there was a problem with the leg. The limp was because for 4 months I'd carried a cast high and changed my whole gait. And there's no normals built into the brain. So whatever you're doing becomes your normal. Well, that now was my normal. In spite of the fact that I had full use of the leg back, I had this new pattern that was my limp. So I had to go back and I had to retrain myself to walk properly. So the calibration problems. So with the hearing, with the balance, the vision, they're tied together. So the calibration, it's like if you break a windshield and you have a newer car and it has all the cameras around it, they have to recalibrate the cameras on the windshield when they put it in. Otherwise, they don't give you any useful information. So we're doing the same thing. So somebody's had a concussion, they lose multifocal points of sound will disorient them and confuse them, and then kicks in your sympathetic nervous system. You're probably getting tired of hearing that, but that's what keeps happening. So what we have to do is we have to recalibrate. So the way we do that is we put them in an environment where there's only one sound source, and then they practice tracking that sound source. Because what's happened when the brain was initially injured, it dumbed itself down, And now instead of thinking 3D sound, it can only do 2D sound. So it can usually tell side to side and sometimes a little bit of up, but virtually no. So what we do is we have to go back and we have to remap the sound. So we do that with the physical input as well. So I'll have them put peppermint on their hand so they know where their hand is. I'll have them use a small Bluetooth speaker and literally move the speaker around their head to remap where the sound is relative to where they are. So what's causing your problems? So it's a matter of the input doesn't match what the patterns are in the brain. So we have to either recalibrate the input, and in some cases, if the brain's been damaged, we have to remake the patterns, the neural patterns that are in the brain, and then we can access the patterns that are stored in the brain. So the visual circuits. So when we're talking visual circuits, the brain, I don't know how much people know about the brain, but with eye motion, when I track something, I have a continuous feed of information. When somebody comes in the door and my eyes quickly jump to the door, my brain actually turns off the input from the eye for a split second, because otherwise all I would see is a blur and I wouldn't be able to interpret that into any patterns. So it turns it off while the saccadic movement, while the quick movement of the eye is going from where I was looking to where I want to look. But if my calibration is off, when I get there, it's not where I want to be. So I have to re-turn it off and then move the eye again. So what I've done is I've slowed down the input and I've decreased the amount of work of data that I have to work with, or I have a large time lag. So that's if I was taking a step and that happens, now I have a big gap in step and I lose my balance. So the balance isn't always about the inner ear. It can be about a conflict between the inner ear and the visual. It can be about a conflict between the hearing and the visual. It can be a conflict from my proprioception. So the proprioception is knowing where you are in space. So again, the same thing, calibration problems are slowing down the processing of the information in the brain, and then that increases your time to do something about the fact that you're falling or to realize if you are falling or not. So we need to recalibrate things to hook them back up so that we can access the patterns we already have, those damaged, remap and build our spatial awareness again. So that's what we do, is we start with the person to have a stable base needs to know where they are in space. So we do exercises with proprioception for the feet. Because if you don't know where your feet are and you try and take a step, you're asking for problems. Same thing with balance. People think balance is all the inner ear. Well, it's part of it is, and then it's your awareness of that, and it's your tying that into your visual. So when those two don't agree, or so with the vision itself, or the balance rather itself, in the inner ear, you have two sets of semicircular canals that run in the three dimensions. It's a left-handed one and a right-handed one. And the fluid inside them moves in each of those canals, and that gives you the input that tells you how you're moving. Well, again, if the calibration is off in this canal, every time I move, this one's gonna think I'm moving more than I am, and I'm gonna try and compensate, but I don't need to compensate, but because I compensated, now I fall to the left every time I turn my head. So we have to recalibrate that. So again, there's ways to do that, and part of that is with heat or cold. So I do what they're called calorics in the office, where we put warm water into the ear on the side that you fall to, and it pushes the brain's aware. It recalibrates the inner ear for your balance ability to push you from that side. So if you're falling to the left, and I do a warm on the left, it'll push you back up to neutral. People can do that for themselves. They can help just by standing in the shower. If they have balance issues, they can sit in the shower and let warm water stream down one side of your head. Again, you have to be aware of triggering yourself with these two. Anytime you start to trigger yourself, you're done with the therapy. You can't keep going. More is not better. Hearing. With hearing, the loud sounds can trigger you, and you can't tell where the sounds are coming from. So this is a scary thing. When you can't tell where a loud sound's coming from, guess what? It kicks in your sympathetic nervous system. So what we do is we try and recalibrate to where you can know where you are in space and where a sound is coming from. So we'll start with being able to track one sound three-dimensionally in space. When you do one sound, then we'll have you walk past a sound source. So you can recalibrate the central nervous system to that so it doesn't get triggered. So the stomach and intestines, they get affected as well. So what happens is, again, every time the sympathetic nervous gets system, it turns it off. So now you're going to have poor digestion. You're going to either have constipation or diarrhea or malabsorption. You're not absorbing the food in there, because if your sympathetic is kicked in, it doesn't care what you have in your stomach. It just wants to survive the next 5 minutes. So again, we need to look at how to get it turned off. And the way to keep it turned off is to understand what the triggers are, how you're triggering it, and doing the exercises to keep it turned off. So how do we access it? Again, through the exercises where we recalibrate, and then through breathing and through the mindfulness. So with the breathing exercises, as we say, where the sympathetic, where the autonomic crosses with the conscious control is our hack points. So one of the easiest ones is breathing. So if you do a couple of short breaths, you'll find that you tighten up and you start to get ready to go. If you do your slow breathing, you do a slow breath in, it calms you. And that's what we want to do. So we want to turn off the sympathetic nervous system. So one of the things that happens too with the sympathetic nervous system being tight, it will cause the esophagus to actually tighten up as well. Now it can't move in the back of the throat, so it tends to pull the stomach up. So when that pulls up, now I have pressure on the bottom of my diaphragm. Well, that's going to further trigger my sympathetic nervous system. And then because that's triggered, it'll cause constriction of more of the esophagus, which tends to pull the stomach up actually through the diaphragm, and you get the hiatus hernia. So we can do in office, we can do physically pulling it back down and trigger therapies on relaxing on the top end of the cervical and the bottom end on the stomach. And then we have another one where it's very complicated. You take a glass of water, you drink the glass of water, you go to your stairs, you go up one stair, you turn around and you jump off. And the physical weight of the water in the stomach helps to pull it down away from the diaphragm. And that's my non-medical hiatus hernia treatment. So what's causing your problems? So the eyes, the pupils are not working in the eyes. So and your depth perception is not calibrated properly, and it's not calibrated to the 3D sound. So all of these things are now triggers. And then if they've been that way for a while, now that's your norm. So that's the whole problem, is we're building bad patterns when we're trying to protect ourselves. So the brain is trying to help you, but in trying to help you, it's causing problems. So understanding that the patterns that we're building are the problems, we have to put ourselves in a safe place, turn off the sympathetic nervous system, work on a new pattern that is helpful to us and that helps us have our integration of the input properly processed. So that's how we're addressing things. So again, the autonomic nervous system, we want the parasympathetic back online, because then we can think, then we can build patterns. And then the danger in doing that is you now have to be aware of any time you're being triggered or fatigued. As soon as you start to feel trigger or fatigue, you have to stop. You stop and you get some water, you need to hydrate, and you need to get something to eat, you need to feed yourself. So people coming in for treatment here, I ask them to have something to eat and have water before they get to the clinic so they can function when they're here. And then I have lower light situations for the rooms because the light is a trigger. I have
Dr. Town.
Yep.
There's a question about why we use peppermint, and I think we'll finish off with this slide. So just if you can explain the peppermint and finish off with the slide, and then we can answer questions.
Okay. Peppermint we use for a number of reasons. Peppermint we use primarily because it's olfactory. Olfactory is cranial nerve, it goes straight to the frontal lobe. It's the only unfiltered input the brain gets, and we're able to access frontal lobe with the peppermint. So that's our big one for peppermint. It helps get your frontal lobe back online.
Okay. And we put it on the feet and the hands. Why do we put it on the feet?
Same thing. It has a tingling effect, and it draws the brain's focus to that area. So I'm trying to tell the person where their feet is in space. I put peppermint on it, and then I mobilize them, and then I have them walk slowly and painfully slowly, actually, because I don't want them in a pattern that they have already. So most people don't walk painfully slowly by themselves. So I teach them how to walk here. So I teach them a style of walking, and when they get good at it, I want them to go slower. So we're consciously rebuilding those patterns, consciously remapping where they are. And the peppermint just helps accentuate and draw the brain's focus to that area. The same thing with the hand. When I'm doing the sound, I put the peppermint on here so I can feel the vibration of the speaker in my hand. And it helps me be aware of where my hand is in space as I move the speaker around. So I'm tying together my proprioception, and I'm tying together my auditory.
And the reason why all of this is important for sleep, all these inputs and all these mismatched patterns put stress on the autonomic nervous system, continuously triggering the sympathetic drive. And if a brain is in high sympathetic drive, it's not going to sleep deeply at night. So you're in high sympathetic drive all day long, with triggering with lights, with sounds, with anxiety. At night, you're trying to turn off the brain. It's going, no, 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 no way. I have to save your life. The brainstem is working full throttle and keeping you in sympathetic fight, flight. And then when it's pushed to the nth degree is freeze to save your life, basically. And that's basically the response to trauma, whether it be physical, mental, emotional. Your brain goes into brainstem, fight, flight, and freeze, save your life. And that's why it continues to do these maladaptive.
You're still muted.
Sorry. I'm sorry about that. So what I was saying was that's why it's so important to address all these patterns, because they trigger and leave the brain and sympathetic nervous system high alert. So during the day, you know, you're triggered by the lights, by the sound, by the noise, the anxiety, the mismatching of patterns. Until those patterns are brought back online during the day, you're still going to be at night triggered, because the brain goes, oh my goodness, there's so many dangers. I'm so triggered. I can't fall asleep. I need to save your life. So it stays in brainstem mode. It's not accessing the frontal lobe. So as we go and shift these patterns, as we go and do exercises and other things that boost the parasympathetic nervous system, then it's easier for me to start to help patients sleep. So we'll leave it over to any questions that people have now. And we're both happy to answer anything you might have in terms of questions or further follow-up.
Hi, thank you both. There was a couple of questions that came across in the question and answer, but also sort of comments in the chat section as well. You answered the peppermint one, which is wonderful. Thank you. There was a question about what's being done, if you know, in Ontario to help promote early education for those with concussions and ABIs.
A lot of the doctors, well, there's seminars. That's where I've over the last 7 years, I've done a lot of seminars, and doctors are encouraged to come to them. But unfortunately, there's not a lot of mainstream information being disseminated. So they're not aware of how to treat these and how to get people back on track.
So an area we can keep working on.
Yep, most assuredly.
Again, in the chat was, have either of you ever explored how craniotomy, sacral therapy would help with some of what you were talking about? I think that came across, especially when you were talking
cranial,
about
this, right? Cranial sacral therapy, the cranium and the sacrum are major innervations of the parasympathetic nervous system. So when you're doing that therapy, you're helping to bring the parasympathetic nervous system back online. And that's a stable, you know, a staple therapy that I send my patients to go do alongside the functional neurology.
Okay, awesome. Thank you. There was one, there's a couple more, but one was in the sleep cycle, REM, deep and light. How many hours is recommended in each stage?
It really depends from age to age. So if you were to Google on the internet, you know, stages of sleep and time spent in sleep, it will come up for you. But the important thing that's happening with sleep, so if you start awake, you go down into deep sleep, then you come into REM and down into deep sleep. People might be spending time in deep sleep and REM, but as you saw, if they're in deep sleep, but the brain wakes them up from deep sleep several times while they're in deep sleep, they're not getting good quality sleep. So a lot of patients will go, oh, I slept for 10 hours, but I'm still exhausted. They didn't get good quality sleep. Their brain is doing these micro arousals throughout the night. Like I said, someone poking their shoulder all night long.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. And I'm not sure if this is something that either one of you can answer, but somebody wrote, I sometimes experience situations where I hear the phone ringing right beside me while sleeping, but I'm experiencing muscle paralysis. It can take me 20 minutes to come through different layers of sleep consciousness before I can move and respond. Is this normal? I don't know if you can. And I'm concerned that the smoke detector will go off and I won't be able to come out of the muscle paralysis phase. It's a tough question to answer when you don't know the person, would be my thought, but.
Well, it's very typical. It's a mismatch. Okay. It's a mismatch again.
Okay, we got to understand that the first part is the muscle paralysis is actually part of the normal sleep you're having. So it shuts. So when you're dreaming, you can be jumping and surfing and doing all sorts of activity, and it doesn't allow your body to respond to that input. So it's a mismatch, as she said. As you're coming out of sleep, that should revert and turn the body back on, but there's a delay there.
Okay.
So as you come back up through awareness, and then it turns back the body back on.
The technical term is sleep paralysis.
Yeah.
It's not dangerous, unless of course there's the fire alarm going, but right. And it doesn't last very long, but it's incredibly scary not to be able to move your body when your mind is awake. So basically part of your brain is still asleep and is preventing you from moving. And that's so that you don't act out your dreams. Because if you dream you're Superman, you fly out the window in your dream, you might actually go fly out the window while you're dreaming. And there are people who do that. That's called REM behavioral disorder. And that can also occur with brain trauma. Okay. So in this case, she has the safer dysfunction mismatch than the other one, which is acting out your dreams.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much. I would like to thank you both, Dr. Town and Dr. Thirlwell, for today's presentation. That was full of so much information that it was really great to hear the two of you talking and presenting. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for having us. And we're open to questions at any time. We can be emailed. Dr. Town, do you want to give them your email?
Yeah, it's westhill.cairo@gmail.com.
So westhill.cairo@gmail.com. And mine is dr, like Dr. Thirlwell, thirlwell@gmail.com. And we are running a mindfulness for insomnia and concussion, mindfulness-based stress reduction for insomnia and concussions starting October. It'll be one night a week. You can email either us about that one night a week for 4 weeks in October, November, and then again in January, February. So you'll learn all these techniques so that you can teach your patients or maybe yourselves if you're suffering from concussion. And concussion can be healed all the way back from if you were concussed when you were 3 years old or 2 years old. We've worked on patients who had concussions 20, 40 years ago, and the mismatches continued that they didn't know about. It led to learning disabilities in school and difficulties with families and relationships and workplace. So it's pretty much an ubiquitous affliction that is not being well managed in the healthcare. So I laud everybody who is in the group today coming to learn, and also all the people who have supported this talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you.